Episode 6 of Bleach. Was it the peak of Bleach? Was this the best anime episode of the year? There's of course going to be a few that say no, and there's going to be a lot of people that say yes. So, dive into this review with me as we explain why this may or may not be the best episode of the year. So, without further ado, let's get into it. Now, I think it goes without saying that this episode as a whole, including myself, got many people speechless in regards to what to actually take in, whether it was the fight scenes, whether it was the choreography, the lighting, the effects, everything that happened, the twists and turns that happened within this episode have really got people riled up in terms of like hype and most definitely excitement. And I think that's mainly the first thing of which we should be talking about in this episode was the fight in general. This is the first episode of Bleach from the Thousand Year Blood War that we get to see a true episode dedicated to a 1v1 fight between Yamamoto Genryusai and Yhwach or Yhwach, whatever you want to again call him. If we're taking this from my manga perspective in comparison to the manga, the anime absolutely accelerated this fight by tenfold because in the manga, it was very quick, it was very fast paced and had a lot of very cool panels. And the whole chapter or the whole fight in and of itself was just a flex on what Yamamoto's Bankai could actually do. And that was the first and foremost, the kind of priority that was given to that fight is just showcasing what it can do only to end it towards the end. And that's fine in all given context, but how the anime accelerated this fight with not only some amazing choreography, some amazing lighting, some amazing intense moments that we're going to be addressing throughout this review, it also had some underlying factors in terms of foreshadowing, inviting new characters or old characters in this sense into the fray, as well as giving a sense of danger that we've already been experiencing from the anime, especially with things such as like Aznot versus Byakuya and seeing the countless Soul Reapers absolutely get plunged. Chojuro, of course, has been given a lot more screen time within the anime as of recently, and it doesn't stop with this episode either. Honestly, if you've seen the episode and watching this review, you already know that this animation was something that we haven't expected from Bleach yet, and it was something that I was anticipating for the longest time. It was one of the main criticisms that Bleach has had since the anime airs of, can we get one of those episodes of which is pure high animation heavy or movie quality in some people's eyes? And that is an episode that had delivered in this. Sure, there was some talking and some dialogue here and there, but for the majority of the part, I would say 60 to 70% was just pure fighting. And we love to absolutely see it because there was a lot of high stakes. The absolute destruction from Yamamoto's Bankai was shown in full force and gives you a sense of why Genryusai Yamamoto is the head captain. And that is something that we've been teased on for the majority of the Bleach series as a whole, especially within the Karakura Town War arc. We actually finally get to see why he didn't use his Bankai in the Karakura Town War arc, because look at the after effects of what it did to the Soul Society when you've got someone like Unohana asking to end this quickly, because if you continue to stay within this form, you are going to essentially, you know, destroy the Soul Society as it is. Which goes to beg the question of, well, you know, how can Yamamoto, once he got to that point, how can he even train with a Bankai? How can he increase or accelerate his own abilities? Well, unless you really go to maybe Squad Zero's palace or even the Mukan, chances are you're really not going to have a fun time with training that Bankai as a whole. So the fact that he was able to increase it, or it got better, supposedly in quotations, after 1,000 years, goes to show that Yamamoto still had time to really refine his own abilities. So animation aside, let's talk about what I really liked within this episode. One being Uryu. And of course, we've talked about Uryu in the past, talking about how he as a character has been fleshed out a lot, which is great because you get to see, in comparison to the manga, his confliction. And it's really important to really give a Quincy arc to a Quincy main character being Uryu. And whether you find it as a reach or not, you know, I think the under the bridge scene is really nice when you got the flowing water, the reflections on under the bridge, and you have him right in the middle. So he's not really chose a side. And I think that this is personally what I believe he's trying to symbolize, is that he's not on one side or the other, and he's smack bang in the middle of that scene, especially under the bridge. So it goes to show that, again, he has his conflicts on who to really side with. But through this, we are getting the perspective of the journal through Soken's eyes. And I think what this episode and what Bleach anime has been doing so well so far is it's really given us a kind of good general idea of a timeline. You know, Chojuro met with Yamaji back 2,000 years ago. That's when he learned his Bankai. Then 1,000 years ago, you had the Quincy War. And then 200 years ago, any surviving Quincy that maybe had a pact with the Soul Reapers, which again, I would love them to elaborate on, then got expunged 200 years ago. And it seems that Soken and maybe a few others, such as Ryuken, did actually get away with that expulsion. You know, maybe they were against what the Quincy's were doing. Maybe they were on the side that conceded. Maybe they were the ones that actually agreed to just not touching Hollows anymore. And given that context, allows us to understand the timeline a little bit better. But something manga readers wanted for the longest time and was hoping throughout the anime adaptation was, are we going to see the thousand year blood war? Are we actually going to see the actual battle itself pan out? And while I think there will be more flashbacks in the future, considering we are going to be getting flashbacks in regards to Basby and Harshwald and Yhwach, you know, maybe we'll get a little bit more in regards to the flashback of those things, or maybe even with the Squad Zero. It seems that, to be honest, if this is all we got in regards to like Yamamoto versus Yhwach a thousand years ago, the parallels, the flashbacks in between the fights, I absolutely loved it and I appreciated it. Because again, if you was to go into the thousand year blood war arc, chances are you're only really going to know about three characters that you care about, plus Yhwach Baha himself and maybe some underlings maybe here and there. You're just going to see a bunch of NPC characters that you're not really going to know about, fodder characters maybe clashing. And to be honest, getting those pictures in Soken's diary is, to be honest, maybe more than enough. I think sometimes it's better to leave things to the imagination than sometimes show things. But again, I'm more than open to see where, you know, Taguchi is going to go further down the line. We're already getting extra content as it is, so I have no stress of the imagination that we are going to get a lot more in the future. So as I said, I enjoyed the parallels. I love to see old Yamamoto fight, you know, the fake Yhwach Baha. And that's essentially where the rage comes a little bit from in terms of Yamamoto and the audience, is that Yamamoto fought a fake Yhwach Bar of the Quincy King. And I personally think there's many perspectives to go from this, and I think when there's many perspectives in a story, I think that's when it's well written. So I would kind of like to elaborate my perspective on this as a whole. Throughout the series that we've had so far, the first five episodes, we have seen Yamamoto absolutely hold back in this aggression, this anger that he's had towards Chojuro's death, and not only the invasion of the Soul Society as a whole. He hasn't had time to grieve, he hasn't really had time to really prepare, and he's got to stay headstrong in front of his soldiers. So you've got to understand the context of how Yamamoto is coming into this battle. He's coming in very angry, he's coming in very emotional, he's not thinking logically. And in his eyes, if you look back at the fake Karakura Town arc, there hasn't been a Soul Reaper that has been stronger than him for the past 1,000 years. So you can also see a sense of a bit of naivety as well. Well, yes, Yamamoto has honed his skills a lot more, such as using Zangonotachi East and West. And the reason why I say that is because it can be alluded that this is the case, seeing as the fake Yhwach, who shares the memories and the mind of the real Yhwach, seems to me that they don't really know about, well, Roy Lloyd doesn't really know about the Skeleton Warriors, you know, the rebirth of the Ashes, and of course North as well, being South and North. So it would seem like the case that Yamamoto was exactly telling the truth, that he didn't really go all out 1,000 years ago, and maybe that's why he was acting so cocky. You've also got to remember too that, hypothetically speaking, 1,000 years ago, Yhwach didn't really have the invention of scripts, nor did he have the Almighty. For those that don't know what that is, you will find out exactly later on. But I'm just trying to give the perspective that 1,000 years ago, Yhwach was just using basic Quincy skills. And because of this can also lead to Yamamoto's naivety of understanding that, hey, Yhwach is back after 1,000 years. He hasn't really changed, nor has he trained at all, because he looks the same and he acts the same, and he's probably coming with a vengeance. And again, that's probably where Yamamoto's mindset is as well, which, as we've learned, is completely wrong. And the fact that we haven't actually seen any of the Stone Riders use their own abilities other than Bankai stealing, Yamamoto in that fact is probably extremely naive to what the Quincy's can do. And even if we look at someone like the Overkill, someone that actually killed Sasakibe himself, or Chojuro, depending on the name that you recognize him by, he only used an arrow that tried to pierce Shuhei, to which is something that Yhwach himself did within their fight between them in this episode. So it seems absolutely plausible from what Yamamoto has seen that he's assuming that Yhwach is the same as he was 1,000 years ago, considering the scarcity of information as well. The only thing that's different in his eyes is that they can steal Bankai, to which to him is kind of redundant. Also, I'd like to add as well that many of you probably didn't notice, or maybe you did or didn't, then one of the flashbacks, when just before he's about to throw the javelin, that Chojuro is in fact on top of a bunch of Quincy bodies as well. So of course it would make absolute sense as well that Chojuro is there on top of the mountain 1,000 years ago of dead bodies, fighting alongside Yamamoto, because he is his right hand man. And it just goes to show a little bit of appreciation towards Chojuro, something we never got in the manga. Chojuro has always been a bit of a lost cause, so you know, the fact that they're trying is very much appreciative nonetheless, to make him not so much of a fodder character after all, but someone that actually did in fact need to be dealt with. And I think it speaks volumes as well, especially as this is Roy Lloyd, someone who is a fake. The fact that it shows how powerful these Stone Ritter are. And I say that with absolute seriousness too, because if you look at fake Karakura Town War Arc, you get to see a lot of the Arrancars, which Aizen preferably didn't really need. You can see this with Hattie Bell, for example. They were just pawns just to move things along or tie down the Gotei 13 so he doesn't have to dirty his hands. But we see that Aizen could take them all on anyway, like single-handedly. We saw it firsthand, for example. But in saying that, you have a main villain being Yhwach Baha, which is incredibly strong. We know this because his Stone Ritter are incredibly strong. And that's important, is that these aren't just fodder characters. These aren't fodder foot soldiers that you're not going to care about after a few episodes. These guys are people actually are a threat. Maybe some Stone Ritters actually, I can tell you for a fact, some Stone Ritters can take on multiple captains at once. And that's the point. It's about threat level. And this is what that episode really drives into. Kenpachi absolutely bodies. And even someone like Roy Lloyd can go toe-to-toe with Yamamoto. Now, granted, he wasn't going toe-to-toe, but he was doing exactly enough to keep him at bay or delayed. You know, to have something like a Blute Vein or Blute Vini, whatever you want to call it, to at least guard himself from 15 million degrees Celsius, the strength of the sun, it's quite an impressive feat, and I don't think people actually realize that. So if we're putting a severity level in terms of like the foot soldiers up against the strongest Soul Reaper that we know of in the Soul Society, I think it speaks volumes about where we are in terms of intensity. And it also goes to show that, you know, Yhwah, even though he's been surviving for 1,000 years and only just got back his intelligence or his mind 90 years ago, goes to show that Yhwah has been extremely, this hasn't been a guy that's been sitting on his chair or sitting in his little shadow realm or sitting in his little palace for ages. This has been someone who's been calculating each specific movement and has been watching the Soul Reapers, has been planning out how he's going to execute these things. So, you know, we're not getting an enemy that's just, you know, the typical shonen, oh, I'm stronger than everybody else, so that means I win. No, he's using things to his advantage, such as he knows that Genryu Yusai is going to be an issue, but not something he can't defeat. But he knows that in order to get that Bankai, for example, he needs to exhaust Yamamoto. And if he thought that Roy Lloyd was the best example of doing that, then he succeeded in that. And I don't think anyone should really be angry at the fact that Yamamoto and Kenpachi lost to a fake Yhwah, but instead look at the context as to why he lost against Yhwah. And I mean, again, emotions can really blind a person who's in a fit of rage and who is cocky, wants them to experience the worst pain imaginable, just like they've done so to him. And that is the change with Genryu Yusai Yamamoto. You are going to see more context within that next episode, talking about Yamamoto's past and his demeanor and his personality. But over 1,000 years ago, he's got very calm, complacent. He's not the same as he was back then. I would like to elaborate more, but again, we are going to get more into that next episode, and I wonder what they're going to add in as well. But the fact that he gets exhausted after using Bankai, he is getting old. I mean, we don't call him Old Man Yama for nothing. So again, in context, it makes a lot of sense, and it explains a lot as well. And again, we get the Aizen scene as well. The Aizen scene was just pure. I love hearing Aizen's voice. I love his cockiness. And also, it was a scene that was originally a 2-text dialogue speech balls that got expanded into a good few minutes. And it was good to see that Aizen, of course, knows who Yhwah Baha is. Makes sense. Aizen's done a lot of research, not only on the Soul King, because we see that in reference again to the fake Karakura Town War arc, but also the Quinces and X, Y, and Z. We don't really need to discuss that. So it makes sense that he understands who Yhwah is. He understands what's going on above, the invasion above, because he talks about the swirling Reishi. And of course, Yhwah knows how strong Aizen is too, and the fact that his immortality is quite a bit of an issue, yet he is strong as well. So if he declines the offer to join the Vandana Lake, then, you know, he's just going to say, well, I'm just going to have to leave here, because he understands where his limits are. And Yhwah is extremely smart in regards to that. And it's always nice to see two villains kind of just talking to each other and about their conflict of interest. And the shorter the path of their involvement is, for the better. And it's kind of interesting whether that's intimidation towards Yhwah, whether he wants to keep him there for a certain amount of time, maybe. Who knows? But I also wanted to mention something about, you know, the restraints on Aizen as well. And I believe that it is really good for shadowing. You're not really going to maybe see this Aizen again until maybe, you know, by the 3rd or 4th core of the anime, so I'll kind of just briefly touch upon it now. In the manga, his restraints are completely enveloped all over his body. You see this towards again the end of the Karakura Town War arc. But it would seem that as soon as Yhwah got close to him, we get to see that his face, his left eye, and his mouth are exposed to some degree. And this is also a callback as well to when Shunsui goes to see him as well. And it's interesting as well because even though his left eye and his mouth are exposed in the eyes of Kyoraku, doesn't mean they're actually exposed. It just means that he's under the illusion because the ceilings themselves only restrain maybe the distance of Aizen's Ryatsu. It doesn't stop them. So it would make sense that after a certain distance, you are still going to get caught slipping. So it's a nice little foreshadowing in regards to that in the future, but it is going to be a long time until you get to see that interaction. Or maybe we'll get more. Who knows what Hiramitsu and Taguchi have up their sleeve. But it was nice that Kubo did in fact write all of that sequence. I can't stress enough how good the fight was in general, because it was just nice to see that all these cool panels that we got in the manga were expanded upon, especially, you know, Zanganata East, for example. We only got to see get one tapped once. In this time, we got it twice. We got a bit of hand-to-hand combat, which was nice as well. Yhwah using his foot to push Yamamoto away, you know, throwing buildings at him. Yamamoto actually putting in some work, and I love the expression of speed as well when he went to go get Kenpachi and go save him as well. And I felt like old Yamamoto wouldn't do this to subordinates. I feel like old Yamamoto would just kind of like have his eyes on the prize. It doesn't matter who's caught in the crossfire. And I feel like this Yamamoto is a bit more sympathetic, which would maybe be Yamamoto's weak side. And I feel like that's what this episode is trying to entail, just how weak Yamamoto actually is within this state of mind and where his state of calmness has come from the society. Him being the top dog for so long is definitely gonna have an impact on you. Bundled with all this stuff is happening because of a fault that you couldn't finish 1,000 years ago too, plus the death of Chojuro, has probably sent him a little bit cuckoo, especially with his age as well. So, and the severity of finishing off the fight quickly as well because of the Bankai being so powerful that it was gonna destroy Soul Society. So, and I didn't even talk about the Skeleton Warriors. Oh my God, the sound effect. If you haven't seen my live reaction, the sound effects from the Skeleton Warriors, hearing the cracks and the bones, even Yamamoto cracking his neck at the start of the episode was like really well done. You cannot favor the art, the sound and art design in this episode enough. The uses of the CG, the flames in the back, hand drawn for the characters, composited well so it was merged together, but also the fact that, like, again, the CG was great. And I say this, some people don't like CG and I get that, but in this case, using like this hell type of landscape, and again, that whole opens up a whole another can of worms for the lore of Bleach and the idea of reincarnation that I do generally want to speak to at some point within, you know, a Yamamoto video or even a reincarnation video as a whole. I did find it interesting that one, we have this hellish landscape, as well as the skeletons themselves have this nice little red hue on them. I thought that that was a good direction to go with. These skeletons aren't exactly strong. However, I do believe that it's nice to see that Yamamoto has an attack ability, has a defense ability, and also a psychological one. So he has an all-round, very beautifully usable Bankai that speaks to its name. And again, believe it or not, there's a lot of skeletons. We're talking in the millions, hundreds of thousands to in the millions here of skeletons that exist. So this episode may not have shown it. The fact that he can do that is pretty awesome as well. And the fact that from the eyes of Yhwah as well, again, to see his old comrades, while for us, we just see normal skeletons, was really nice POV shots as well. So camera angles were on point, sound design was on point, animation in general was on point, keeping the art on model was on point, composition was amazing, and of course the music. Usually Sagasu carries and elevates these episodes, but in fact, I think Sagasu was maybe one of the weakest. And that's not saying anything, because Sagasu hasn't changed. He's still keeping the consistency with the high quality. So it just means everything else elevated past that. So that's my overall view. I think there's a lot of things to question within this episode. For example, like, why didn't Yamamoto use Kido? You know, why haven't the Soul Reapers in general use Kido? But these are like little nitpicks. I think for what the episode was trying to do, create a theme, show how strong Yamamoto was, while at the same time showing his emotion and the characteristics between these two, was done absolutely perfectly. There's not a thing you can't talk about in this episode. And especially for us as the audience, the fact that it's been made very clear of where the breaking point was for the fake Yhwah, but couldn't be seen by Yamamoto himself was really telling on how ignorant Yamamoto is in terms of letting his emotions get over the fact of his logic. For example, someone like Yhwach wouldn't scream from seeing his dead subordinates. Someone who casually just gets rid of his subordinates at the blink of an eye. Someone who, you know, just gets rid of people left, right, and center from episode one and episode two. You know, this is a ruthless guy. He's not going to really have any kind of emotion towards X, I guess, Quincy's that he used to deal with back 1,000 years ago. And I feel like that was the breaking point for the fake Yhwach, and where we get to see that that's a demeanor change. And the fact that, you know, Yamamoto kind of notices but brushes it off as like, oh, I guess you do have more humanity. And maybe the ignorance from Yamamoto and his desire to make Yhwach seethe or even despair was more important than actually seeing the rose-tinted glasses, the actual view of reality of what was going on. And I appreciate that, because, you know, Yamamoto wasn't seeing things how we were seeing, and you could tell that. Again, great writing on that part, and he saw the flowers of that. I guess, rest in peace, Okiba. He didn't last long. He had like a few seconds of screen time, but rest in peace to him. This episode is just great. There's a lot to talk about and a lot to review, but overall, it was a 10 out of 10 in my eyes, and it did exactly everything I expected it to, and will be, at the moment, the peak of Bleach, because I know it's been a long time that this episode's been worked on, longer than any of the episodes that we've witnessed so far. I don't know if we'll have this kind of episode again within this core, but that doesn't go to say that we won't have episodes that don't come close to it at the very least. So, with that being said, what did you guys think? Is this the best episode of the Bleach core so far? I think so. That being said, I'm gonna catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day, been Hanson, and as always, people, peace out.